we need to separate issues about the Big Bang into two. One is that there was an event, a period of time we know a fair amount about 13.7 billion years ago. And by direct observation, by theory, we know something about the kind of matter there was, the temperatures, the densities, how light went through that, how it cooled down. And a lot of cosmology is studying the time from that forward and trying to push our understanding both by observation and by theory back as early as we can get. So one issue that obviously occurs to everybody is that thing we call the Big Bang, was there anything before that? Did that come out of anything? Was there any story we can tell, any physical story we can tell about the origin of the Big Bang? The answer right now is that we don't know. And all options are on the table. Probably 80 years ago, the Big Bang theory was associated with the idea that no, there's nothing that you could say space and time itself began. And therefore, there was nothing before it because there was no before before it. Modern cosmological theory imagines another possibility, which is that there was something before this thing we call the Big Bang, that there was another state from which our observable universe evolved, and other observable universes continue to evolve, different kinds of universes that maybe look very different from ours. So there are theories of that character. Now, let me just say a word about the idea that on the first model, you might say, doesn't that mean the universe came from nothing? And that sounds very strange. And part of the strangeness has to do with people being a little sloppy about the word nothing. So here's an old philosophical joke, half puzzle. Someone says, I've got a proof that a ham sandwich is better than heaven. And the proof has two premises. One is that nothing is better than heaven, and the other is a ham sandwich is better than nothing. And therefore, right, a ham sandwich is better than heaven. And you say, I know something's gone wrong with that argument, right? What's gone wrong with it? Well, because we use the word nothing in different ways. And when I say nothing is better than heaven, I'm not saying there's this thing better than heaven. We call it nothing. So when people say on the one model, the Big Bang came from nothing, what they mean is there isn't anything it came from. So you don't ask the further question, well, what is this nothing it came from? What you're expressing is there just isn't anything. It is the complete totality. Once you trace back to a certain point, space and time themselves don't go any further. And if time doesn't go any further, to ask what happened before the Big Bang is just logically incoherent. There can't be a before. Now, we don't know that that's the way it is, but if it is that way, it's not the right question to ask. Does that mean that nothingness somehow gave birth to the universe? That sounds very strange. You're going to say, no, nothingness didn't give birth to the universe. There isn't anything that gave birth to the universe. The universe is a kind of totality. It's a whole. It's everything there is. And it's limited in a certain way. It's limited in the time extent that you can go backwards. Now, on the other model, where there was something before the Big Bang, you can then ask, what came before it? How did the Big Bang come out of that? Can I trace even further back? And at that point, we're not going to find out much using our big telescopes. We're not going to find out much using the kinds of resources that give us a lot of very interesting information about the observable universe. All we have to go on is theory, and cosmology switches over from the astronomers to the theoreticians, who might say, yeah, I have a theory that will tell you what this earlier state was like. And then you could only ask the theory, can I keep going back? Can I keep going back? Does it go back forever? Now, in the case of going backward in time, it's interesting to notice that no matter what you do, people will be upset. If you go back in time to a certain point and then stop, they're going to say, well, that's strange. How could time itself begin? But if you never stop, you're going to say, well, how could an infinite amount of time have elapsed? You know, how could we get to now if you had to go through an infinite amount of time to get here? So there's kind of perpetual discontent. This was something that was, I guess, noticed by Kant. And he just said, well, all the answers to these questions about the whole cosmos, the cosmological questions about everything taken together, are going to feel dissatisfactory. There can't be a further explanation of everything taken together, because if you appeal to something further, you haven't taken everything together in the first place. So if you think the cosmological context comes with certain problems inherent in what it is. If you're dealing with everything, then there are going to be certain kinds of explanations or certain kinds of understanding, which automatically, by logic, there can't be for everything taken together, that there can be for any little part, right? So if I can ask, of the United States, how did it begin or how did it come about? And there are earlier things you can talk about in a process that leads to it. But automatically, if I say, I want to ask that question about the totality of everything, well, automatically there can't be anything else I appeal to explain it, because then I wouldn't have had everything in the first place.